Traditionally, three major players lead the way in cable manufacturing and installation. Among them, there is a French company, Alcatel Submarine Networks, a subsidiary of the Nokia company. The cables are then operated by telephone operators, such as the French Orange. But recently, other protagonists have joined the game. The first are the American companies that dominate the internet market, the famous GAFAM. In order, we find Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, and Microsoft. These residents of Silicon Valley in California are the dominant players of the globalized internet, where they also host most of the root servers that sort our internet browsing. One figure gives an idea of the power of GAFAM. Google's search engine was visited 90 billion times in December 2021. This makes it the most consulted web interface in the world. A domination challenged in some countries like China or Russia, who invest in their own internet giants. For example, it is impossible for a Chinese person to access the latest Netflix series, to wish a happy birthday on Facebook, and even less to watch a looking for video on YouTube. Instead, they have to use the social media allowed in China. But the GAFAM have a desire to expand and increase their influence and would like to control the infrastructure in addition to the content of the internet. In 2020, in partnership with Orange, Google had a new transatlantic cable laid called Junon. Meta, the parent company of Facebook, in conjunction with Orange and Vodafone, has done the same with the 6,800-kilometer-long Friendship cable. The estimated cost of the operation is 250 million euros. According to Orange, Junon and Amitié will be able to circulate more information than all the previous transatlantic cables. Deep in the ocean, they are weaving their own digital web, and they are moving very fast. In 2022, Alphabet, the parent company of the giant Google, was the exclusive owner or co-owner of 21 undersea cables, a trend that is accelerating as most of the upcoming projects are initiated by or in association with GAFAM. Companies want to meet their massive data needs and anticipate the explosion of global internet traffic. In the future, they may be able to distribute this digital information traffic as they wish and to their advantage. Today, telecom operators who manage the cables are required to respect net neutrality. They must not interfere with what is circulating in the data carried by the optical fiber. But GAFAM do not have this obligation. Another newcomer to this strategic market is China. In 2019, the Hengtong Group bought the branch dedicated to submarine cables from Huawei, an acquisition by a company close to the Chinese government that has developed into a new heavyweight in the sector. A newcomer that is multiplying cable renovation projects all over the world and is playing a decisive role in the construction of future infrastructures of this type. To understand Beijing's logic, we need to go back to the surface for a moment and look at the country's geopolitics. The country led by the Chinese Communist Party has long locked down what can and cannot be transmitted on its internet. The country, the second largest economy in the world, aims to shake up the established world order and to gain influence, especially with its regional neighbors. Being able to lay cables, to control the infrastructures where sensitive data circulate, would be one more weapon to extend its influence. The United States, which has entered into a commercial and technological confrontation with China, is trying to block or bypass the country's numerous submarine projects. This approach is followed by many countries allied with the United States in the region. The latest example is the Apricot cable, which aims to link Singapore, Japan, Guam, the Philippines, Taiwan, and Indonesia by 2024. This cable should make it possible to bypass the South China Sea and therefore Beijing's right to control the data that passes through it. These cables carry both civilian and military information, making them an underwater gold mine. The United States knows something about this, as several scandals have revealed that it has long been using these cables for espionage operations. As proof of this massive surveillance, in 2021, Danish public television revealed that the country had allowed the United States to connect to undersea cables for espionage purposes. Operations that took place between 2012 and 2014, targeting allied countries such as Germany and its chancellor at the time, Angela Merkel. information that confirms the revelations of the famous whistleblower Edward Snowden. A former agent of the U.S. intelligence agency, the NSA, he had revealed the practices of systemic eavesdropping using, among other things, submarine cables, a global surveillance system from which France is not excluded. The French secret services, the DGSE, can also spy. It is even authorized by law. The Code of Internal Security indicates that this surveillance is possible for purposes of defense and promotion of the fundamental interests of the nation. At the international level, a first treaty ratified by 36 countries was signed in 1884. It only lays down generic rules, such as the freedom to lay submarine cables on the high seas. These prescriptions were then taken up again without any real depth by the various conventions on the law of the sea. A legal vagueness that reinforces the competition between states. Aware in their importance in matters of national sovereignty, countries are equipping themselves militarily to protect this fragile network. The vulnerability of underwater infrastructures was also brought to light after the sabotage actions in September 2022 against the Nordstream 1 and 2 gas pipelines carrying hydrocarbons between Russia and Germany. In the past, cutting submarine cables was commonplace during a conflict to destabilize the adversary. Today, their multiplication makes a massive undertaking to isolate a country more difficult. To isolate France, a simultaneous attack on the 23 submarine lines connected to the territory would be necessary. France is the most connected country in the European Union. This does not prevent numerous attempts. In February 2023, two submarine cables were cut by Chinese ships between China and Taiwan. The relationship between the two countries has been conflictual for a long time, since Beijing considers Taiwan to be an integral part of its territory. The fear of a military attack is increasingly raised as a possible scenario. In this context, the six-day delay between the two blackouts suggests that they could have been intentional, as the website Le Grand Continent writes. These infrastructures are not immune to natural disasters either. In 2006, still near Taiwan, an earthquake of magnitude 7.2 occurred off the island and damaged several of these information routes. The result? More than 120 million telephone lines were disrupted and commercial and banking exchanges came to a halt. But there is more. Some people predict the death of undersea cables in the medium term. This is the case of Elon Musk, a communication coup that the fantastic American billionaire is fond of. In our video on the projects of colonization of the Moon and Mars by man, we talked about his project to install a human colony on the Red Planet by the end of the century. If you're interested, I'll put this video in the description below. But if the boss of Tesla, SpaceX, or Twitter preaches this announced end, it is not by chance. He wants to replace them with his network of satellites called Starlink, a mega project that aims to provide internet everywhere on the planet, thanks to a constellation of several tens of thousands of satellites placed in low-altitude orbit. An option that is gaining momentum, but does not seem to divert investments for the submarine cables of the future. As proof, by 2024, a cable of more than 45,000 kilometers linking 33 countries will be in operation. Called To Africa, it aims to strengthen connectivity between Africa, Europe, and Asia. This will be the longest cable in the world and is financed by a consortium of companies including Orange, Vodafone, China Mobile, and Meta, the parent company of Facebook. In total, the To Africa cable is expected to contribute to the connectivity of 3 billion people in the world, or 38% of the world's population. A pharaonic project on which we leave today. In any case, I hope that you will have enjoyed this slightly off-series topic. If so, don't hesitate to tell me in the comments and to subscribe to the channel so you don't miss the next videos. Thank you for watching and see you soon on Looking For. Goodbye.